going.
Do we have someone that's watching it?
That's as best as possible.
Yeah, that was beautiful.
Everyone, it's great to see you, whether you're here with us live in the drive or on Facebook or Zoom. I have no idea how your sound is every place else, and so at any rate, I just pray that you can bear with us, but it's so good to see people on three different platforms. That's amazing. God is awesome, isn't he? Nothing will stop God's people from gathering together. We are one in spirit, And that's important because today is Pentecost. I want to welcome you here to C3 today on this Pentecost Sunday when we celebrate the birth of the church, Jesus sending his Holy Spirit to fill us, to enable us for his work, to guide us and lead us, to comfort us, to strengthen us, to fill us with gifts. What an awesome thing that we have, a gift that we have in the Spirit. So, hey, if you're worshiping with us online or here in the drive, you can find our bulletin online at www.c3anchorage.org. You can also find our song sheets online at that same address. So hopefully you'll have a chance to connect there. For those people who are here, we have a few copies, but we're trying to make sure everyone is safe. We respect and are grateful for every one of you who's connecting today. I know some people have just been ready to get out and feel comfortable doing so, and others are not, and some of you shouldn't be here. So I'm just grateful that we have all these ways we can connect. And so much grace is given. For those who are here, we have got our seating set up that you don't have to be very close to each other. We have face masks available for people who may want them. And we're just grateful that you're gathered here with us today. I just ask you to join me in prayer as we open up this service. Lord God, Heavenly King, Master of the universe, God of all grace and goodness, God of all power and might, God of love, God of forgiveness, God of mercy. Lord, we come to you. You are holy beyond our understanding. You are mighty and larger than life, larger than everything, yet you are concerned about each and every one of us. We are grateful that we serve a God who is so strong, yet so gentle, so loving and kind, yet so powerful and just. Lord, you are our everything. As we worship you this morning, we join the angels in heaven who constantly are singing to you, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. May the earth be full of your glory.
Oh,
this next song, some of our kids and youth know a little bit better. And are you going to help them out on this one?
Yeah. Yeah, kids all in the park, you want to come over a little bit?
Maybe.
They're playing. We'll have fun regardless.
All right. Adults then, that's fine. Awesome. We had a few helpers here, so praise God for that, and glad to see people keep showing up. Just as a reminder for those of you who've joined us maybe a little bit late, the lyrics for our songs and other items are on our website, www.c3anchorage.org, so make use of that. I already mentioned today that this is Pentecost. It is 50 days after Easter. And there was a festival back in old times where people would come to Jerusalem. It was kind of a harvest festival. It was also a celebration of when God traditionally gave the Ten Commandments on Mount Sinai. But God always promised from the oldest times that one day he wouldn't write his law on tablets of stone, but on the hearts of men and women. That he would put his spirit in us and teach us that way. And that prophecy, that promise came true on the day of Pentecost. If you remember, the believers were gathered together in one place, and suddenly a sound like a rushing wind came, and flames of fire were on all their heads. And they started speaking in different languages so that people who gathered in Jerusalem could understand these men and women praising God in their own language. God poured out his Spirit that day to enable us to fulfill what he asked us to do at the end of Matthew, which is to go in all the world and make disciples of all nations, not just those that spoke one language, but every tribe and tongue. And that he would make us his witnesses, as he said in Acts 1:8. And I think what we should be doing today is praying for a fresh outpouring of the Spirit. So there are some words in your song sheets that I'm going to ask you to pray with me. This is an old prayer I found that asks God to once again pour out his Spirit upon us. So let's do that. Would you read with me or pray with me? Breathe in me, O Holy Spirit, that my thoughts may all be holy. Act in me, O Holy Spirit, that my work too may be holy. Draw my heart, O Holy Spirit, that I love but what is holy. Strengthen me, O Holy Spirit, to defend all that is holy. Guard me then, Holy Spirit, that I always may be holy. Amen. Holy basically means set apart for a purpose. And God has set you and me, his church, apart for a great purpose. But we can't do it in our own strength. Thank God he doesn't expect us to. He pours out his Holy Spirit to all who would ask, all who would receive, freely given because of the sacrifice Jesus made for us. There's nothing worth more than having a relationship with Jesus and having the Holy Spirit of God live within you.
And see the sweetest of love, and my heart begins.
Singing with us again today, and normally we'd take a break right now, but we don't have any refreshments to share. The Holy Spirit has refreshed us, though. I hope he's refreshed you. So we are just privileged to have you here with us. I'm going to ask you now just to kind of grab your Bibles if you got them, and I'm going to be turning over to my friend and brother here, Pastor Kyle, who's going to bring us a message today in our series. In our series on preparation, perseverance, and purpose. We've been going through the book of 1 Peter. Just as background again, Peter writes this letter to some Christians who are on the outskirts of the known world at the time, the empire. And he was writing to get them all prepared for the days that were coming ahead where they might face trials and tribulations. So with that, Kyle is now in the house. Give it up for Kyle. Praise God.
Hey, Kyle. Happy birthday.
Yeah. Is it?
Somebody embarrassed.
So we're switching mics because Ben knows that I like to spit a lot when I talk, and he didn't want to sing into the same microphone after, so I get my own. So good morning. Before we get started, we do have a birthday today. I think she ran. Sophie is 14 years old today. Where'd she go? Sophie! Come here, we're all gonna sing happy birthday to you quick.
Even if you don't come here.
Even if you don't come. Alright, here we go. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Sophie. Happy birthday to you. Woo! So this next week she's gonna make me go get her learner's permit. So. Well, good morning, everybody. It is awesome to be back together in person, at least a little bit for some of us. And hopefully this is a sign that things are getting better. And I know that we got some folks that are still tuned in via Facebook and via Zoom. People are still hunkering down. And this is kind of our test week, by the way, also. This is our first week back in person. So the technology piece, we're trying to figure this out. If something doesn't work, let us know. But I'll be really honest here. This is kind of a weird time to be alive for me. I didn't think that I would ever be alive during the time of a pandemic. And as a kid, you know, you read like stories, history books, right? Like the plague and the Spanish flu and all of these things. And never did I think, like, I would be here during a pandemic. And now I get to be that old grandpa someday that's like, back in 2020, you know, when the pandemic happened, I get to have that story. It's kind of neat. But speaking of kind of a weird time to be alive, it's kind of a weird place as a church. And we are in this season of transition. And the obvious transition is that we're slowly moving back to meeting in person. And for now, we'll settle with a smaller group, 6 feet apart. And hopefully this pandemic comes to an end. And then we'll see everyone else being able to join us shortly. But there's more to just this transition than just our ability to, I think, meet in person again. About a month ago, I think it was during our Holy Week devotionals, I got to do one of these devotionals, and I got to talk a little bit of kind of what the new normal was going to be like. And I think that Pastor Ben and the leadership team have done a great job of leading us in the direction that we need to be going. And there's still a lot of stuff up in the air. There's still a lot of unknowns. And so keep our church leadership in your prayers this week and beyond as we move forward. So this week, as Ben said, we are continuing in the book of 1 Peter. And as I was reading the text for this morning, I was really struck by how applicable it is to the church today, and especially as we're going through this time of transition and time of uncertainty. And for those of you who haven't been following along in the past couple weeks, we've been in the book of 1 Peter, which was written by
Peter.
No surprise there. And Peter was one of Jesus' disciples. He was a witness to the sufferings of Christ. Most people remember Peter as the guy that denied Jesus 3 times the night he was arrested. But Peter was a disciple of Jesus. This is a guy who lived with Jesus. He loved with Jesus, and he learned from Jesus. And Peter's first letter was written while he was in Roman territory, potentially even Rome itself. And this letter was written to Christians that were dispersed across a large portion of what is now modern-day Turkey. And Peter is writing these letters. Again, he's in Roman-controlled territory, writing to people in areas that have been influenced by Greek and Romans, but they were firmly under Roman control. And Peter writes this letter to these Gentiles living in these areas, and he speaks of how they are to conduct themselves as exiles. And now this is where we're going to kind of settle today. And some of the people that Peter was writing to were no doubt, in fact, actual exiles, right? They were living in a place that was not their home. But what Peter is really talking about here is this call to live as spiritual exiles, that this earth is temporary and that our eternal gift, that our eternal home awaits us. And you're like, hey, Pastor Kyle, this is a really long intro. Great. Yeah, there's more. Don't worry. So there's reason that this is important, because if we're going to understand what Peter is saying in this letter, I think we need the context. And at the time that this was written, where it was written, in Roman-controlled territory, Christians were routinely questioned. They were regularly charged with crimes because of their faith. And Peter is writing to a group of people that were living lives under scrutiny and persecution because of their faith. And in some cases, they were suffering because of their beliefs. And the entire theme behind the entire letter in 1 Peter is to those who would persevere in the faith while suffering persecution, that these people should be full of hope because they get to enjoy hope since they're already enjoying the promise of God's salvation. And what I love about this text that we're going to read today is what Peter has to say about how we are to live righteously, right, in our homes and in our lives and in society. So we're going to read this together. If you have your Bibles, you can turn to 1 Peter chapter 2. We're going to be there, and we're going to be starting in verse 11. And if you have the same Bible I do, it's page 2048, but since nobody has this Bible, it's at the back. Or if you have a phone, I guess. That's probably easier. Everybody says Bible on their phone now. Alrighty, so starting in verse 11, it says this. It says, "Beloved, I urge you as sojourners and exiles to abstain from the passions of the flesh, your soul. Keep your conduct among the Gentiles honorable, so that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may see your good deeds and glorify God." Let's stop there for a second. Again, remember, he's writing to people in exile, physically and spiritually. He's writing to people who are enduring harassment and suffering because of their faith. And he's simply saying, live honorable lives. Live lives that point to Jesus, your salvation, that because of who you are and how you act, that people are going to see God's goodness through you. And before we go any further, I actually want to do a little bit of experiment. I was questioning whether or not I want to do this today, but let's try it. Because sometimes when we read scripture, we have a tendency to either see it through a historical lens or we try to kind of apply it now. And I want to do both, and I want to do both at the same time. So as we read the rest of chapter 2, and we're going to, I want us to think about what this would have meant for people living under Roman rule. People being persecuted, people being questioned because of their faith. So we're going to think about that. And I also want this to think about how this applies to us. So this isn't going to be the part of the sermon where everybody tunes out for 3 minutes while we read the rest of chapter 2. I want everybody to kind of switch your brains on, switch into high gear for this exercise. Everybody ready?
Ready.
Okay, here we go. Full disclosure, this probably was not a super popular message when it was written from Peter to these people. And similarly, it's not an overly popular message now, but we'll get there. So let's go. Starting back up in verse 13. Be subject for the Lord's sake to every human institution, whether it be to the emperor as supreme or to governors as sent by him to punish those who do evil and to praise those who do good. For this is the will of God, that by doing good you should put to silence the ignorance of foolish people. Live as people who are free, not using your freedom to cover up for evil, but living as servants of God. Honor everyone, love the brotherhood, fear God, and honor the emperor. Servants, be subject to your masters with all respect, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the unjust. For this is a gracious thing, when mindful of God, one endures sorrows while suffering unjustly. For what credit is it if you sin and are beaten for it and endure? But if you do good and suffer for it, you endure. This is a gracious thing in the sight of God. For to this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example, so that you might follow in his steps. He committed no sin, neither was deceit in his mouth. When he was reviled, he did not revile in return, and when he suffered, he did not threaten, but continued entrusting himself to he who judges justly. He bore our sins in his body on the tree that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed, for you were straying like sheep, but now have returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls. How did that work? Were you able to put yourself in the place of the original recipients of that letter? Were you able to see that through a kind of a modern day lens? I said, it wasn't probably a popular message back then either. No doubt these Christians were upset with the situation that they were in. No doubt there was a desire to strike back or do something against the Roman Empire. And what Peter's saying here is honor him. Honor him. And by doing so, you live lives that set you apart from everyone else. So what we're reading about here is a couple of things. There's a couple points. If you're note takers, here you go. Big point number one. It's about bringing glory to God in the middle of a hostile world. A place where that's a hard thing to do. A place where fitting in is easier than living set apart. Where complaining about circumstances is easier than glorifying God while enduring. Where hiding from our calling is easier than bearing witness to the gospel. And secondly, this is about submission to authority. And I know that there's many of you out there, maybe as we were going through this exercise, how this applies, maybe even a couple names or faces popped into your mind as we're reading this text. But regardless of who or what you were thinking, we are told to be good subjects, to be good citizens. That through our lifestyles that people would know the goodness of the God that we serve. And I know a lot of people that struggle with this, and I can say that confidently because I do. We live in a place where, for the most part, we don't endure persecution at the same level as other places in the world. And what Americans call persecution sometimes would hardly be considered an inconvenience, I think, in many other places in the world. And yet we struggle at times to submit in a way that honors God. And I know the idea of submission or submitting to someone or something isn't a popular topic. We are told by our culture that we have to be independent, we have to have an opinion about everything, we have to be angry with something, that we have to pick a side to be on, that we have to identify with an earthly team. Whether that's a political or racial or social, but what we're told here and all throughout the Bible is that our submission to authority is possible only by full submission to God first. For us to truly understand that submission, that enduring inconvenience and yes, even persecution and even wrongdoing isn't just a suggestion. We're told to. And that we have Jesus as the example. Let me ask you this question. I was questioning whether or not I wanted to go here this morning too, but you know what? I'm gonna. And this speaks to why submission, this idea of living where we are, how we are, and living godly lives and glorifying God matter. Have you ever brought someone to Christ by arguing about politics? Have you ever shown the love of God by demeaning someone on Facebook? A particular leader in your life, your boss, local leaders, national leaders? Have you ever honored God by fighting back when others pushed your buttons? I'd be willing to take a wild guess and say the answer to all those questions are no. And before anybody thinks I'm crazy, I'm not saying we shouldn't vote, that we shouldn't be involved, we shouldn't advocate for social justice. That's not what I'm saying, and that's not what Peter is saying. The church can and should be a truth-speaking, life-giving, society-changing thing. We should. We are blessed to live in a country where we can fix stuff that's broken. We engage in ways that help people, but when the call doesn't go our way, when things get rough, when we as Christians are simply called to submit to God and endure, if necessary, what this world throws at us. It's about seeing this world through the lens of eternity. It's about submitting first to the God of the universe and his plan for us to live for the kingdom of heaven. If winning an argument is more important than being able to witness, then we've got it backwards. If fighting back and hurting those who have wronged us in our lives is more important than glorifying God, we've got it backwards. If constantly complaining about local, state, and national leadership is more important than going and loving people in the name of Jesus, then we have it backwards. The submission that Peter is talking about here isn't about rolling over and playing dead. It's not about locking ourselves away in a closet out of reach of things that are uncomfortable. It's not about separating ourselves from community. It's simply about priorities. We know that as we go through life that we are going to experience bad stuff. And much of it will be far out of our control. And while the rest of the world flails its arms and yells about how unfair things are, we as believers are called to see this life differently. That we as exiles here in this world, with our true home in heaven, that we are not of this world, we are simply in this world. That our eternal home is in heaven, and that everything that we do should point others to that direction. Folks, just because it's in the Bible doesn't make it easy. It's true, but it doesn't make it easy. Let me ask you another question. Do you see God as having established your bosses, your representatives, your president, people in a life that have authority over you, and even those that may be ungodly? Do you see God as having established them in your life? I'll say this, many of us are guilty before God because we have touched God's authority with our criticisms, our abuse, and our attacks. And folks, I confess, again, I am guilty of this. Does that mean that we don't recognize wrong? Of course not. Of course we do. But the manner in which we do it makes all the difference. The heart that we do it with and the impact on our witness makes the difference. Does our response to things in this world mock or belittle or disrespect or encourage rebellion in others? Because if we do that, then we have dishonored God. And we go back all the way to Romans chapter 13, and I'd love to read the first half of Romans 13, but I'm just going to read verse 2. It says this, "Consequently, he who rebels against the authority is rebelling against what God has instituted, and those who do so will bring judgment on themselves." Folks, this is not an easy thing to do. For those of you with Facebook, and I know some of you are on Facebook this morning, you can't be on social media for more than 2 minutes before you see exactly what we're talking about, complaining and mocking and being angry, and which is, by the way, easy. It's probably why so many people do it. In our online world, I think complaining out loud is probably turned into one of the most common events that we see. And folks, I want to go right back to the scripture that we just read in Peter's letter where he tells us that our example for how to live is Jesus. We talk about Jesus being the example of how we are to serve and how we are to love and how we are to sacrifice, but what Peter is talking about here is that Jesus is our example of how to endure in this life. Even when the circumstances aren't fair, even when things don't go our way, and that when we endure in Christ, we do so that our witness to the world will be what people see. I know that there's a lot of people, especially considering recent events in our country with the pandemic, the events in major cities, tension along racial lines, injustices that our country, our mission field is heavily divided. And as people of Christ, we are called to act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with God's direction. We will never live in a place where we agree on everything, and we will never live in a place where earthly teams are not at odds with each other. We will never live in a place that is perfect until Christ comes again. Amen?
Amen.
So how do we endure during this time? From the cross to the second coming, how do we endure? How do we maintain our witness to people in our lives while we disagree on such seemingly important things? We love like Christ. We surrender. We submit to God and his plan, and we live lives that glorify God. This idea of submission to earthly authorities, I'll be honest, it's a bit of a head-scratcher right at times, but ultimately it comes down to two things. In submitting to civil authorities, we are doing what is pleasing to God, and we are representing God in such a way as to bring him honor, glory, and praise. God desires for his people to be a people to love God with all of our heart, soul, and mind, and then to go and love other people. God desires his people to be a people of obedience, people who don't just teach the word or read the word, but people who do the word, people who obey his word. We are called to be more than people that just come to church on Sunday morning. He wants us to worship him every day by doing his word. And I know that there's a lot of division in this country. There's a lot of people who feel strongly about a lot of different things. And I know Christians in my life that are fanning flames of hate. Those who have become part of the problem, people who have spoiled their witness. So to close our sermon today, I want to spend some time in prayer. And Billy Graham has one of the greatest quotes regarding this. He says, "You cannot pray for someone and hate them at the same time. Even if you are asking God to restrain their evil actions, you should also be praying that he will change their hearts. Only eternity will reveal the impact of our prayers for others." And folks, we got a lot to pray for today, so let's do that. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your word to us this morning. We pray that you would continue to work on our hearts, that we would be a people completely surrendered to you, that our lives would reflect that submission, that we would be ready for you to show the love of Christ into a broken and sinful world, and that our actions as we endure hardship would point others to you and to eternity. Lord, we pray for our leaders, our pastors, our bosses, our local and national leaders. We pray that you would give them wisdom, that you would give them peace. And Lord, we pray that they would seek you and your will, and that your will would be done here on earth. Lord, we pray for those across the country who are hurting. We pray for those who are in pain. We pray for those who don't know how to respond to things that are going on, from the pandemic to racial divides, to those struggling to reconcile your goodness with the evil that is so present in this world. And Lord, we pray for peace. We pray that hearts would be softened. We pray that lives would be changed, that you would redeem these things that our adversary uses to divide, and that you would redeem them so that people, more people, would come to know you, that your eternal kingdom of heaven would see souls won for the Lord, that in these times of uncertainty and pain, that hearts would turn to you, and while enduring in these times, that people would seek you in the hope, grace, and love that can only be found in you. Amen. Mike Swell.
So we're going to...
It would help if I use a mic, right? We're going to be closing with a song and just some catch-up on some announcements here. But I just want to really appreciate my brother Kyle for touching on a difficult subject. And again, I think there's a lot of us that are struggling to understand how to respond in this time. And again, I just want to lift up exactly what Kyle said. There are ways. I wish the people who were cleaning up after the rioters and loving their neighbors were getting as much press as those who are doing that. And I certainly respect people's right to speak up and call out injustice, and there is much to call out. But we do it in a different way than the world does. Jesus said, "Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good." That is our call. So Pastor Sarah's here to kind of catch us up on a couple of events here before we do our final close.
Yeah, well, I would say good morning, but actually it's afternoon. So good afternoon, you guys. The first announcement is that we are going to be doing Live in the Drive every week at 12 p.m. So here at the Unity Center driveway, 435 Standish Street, we will be here. We'll have some worship, a message, and it's a family service. So kids are around. Bring your kids. Bring your families. We are just trying to encourage you guys for this time and support social distancing and all of the guidelines set in place by our authorities, local authorities. So welcome. I'm happy you're here. Feel free to invite a friend. Let them know that we are going to be here every Sunday, Live in the Drive at 12 p.m. The other announcement is youth ministry. So we are going to be doing something a little different this summer. We've been doing youth group Wednesday nights, but this upcoming Wednesday, we have something kind of special that'll be happening in the driveway at 7 p.m. for middle schoolers. And then the following Friday, so Friday the 12th, we're going to have all middle school and high school combined with another youth group, and we're going to be meeting at Grandview at 6 p.m., so 6 to 8. So let me know if you're interested in that, if you have some students that are interested. You can give them my contact info if you want to know more about what we're doing, any of that, let me know. Reach out. You can text me, email me, call me, all the other things, Facebook. There's a lot of forms of communication now. So I'm glad you're here. I'm excited for what God is doing in the neighborhood. He continues just to blow me away, bringing people here to C3, and it's been awesome to see some. We've just started kind of meeting again for youth, and so it's been awesome to see some old faces and new faces as well. So continue to pray for our next gen ministry, which is birth through college. God is doing incredible things in this next generation. Thanks, you guys.
And I'm really just grateful to God how God has used you in reaching out to our neighborhood. A lot of people don't see it with the pandemic going on, but it's still happening. Hey, just another reminder, our website, check it out. You can share prayer requests. You can catch up on announcements there. You can do online giving, or if you're here this morning, there's a box for our giving here. So I'm just going to pray real quick for the offering, and then I want to share a song, a blessing, final one with you. Lord, you are awesome. The whole earth is yours. Nothing is too hard for you. We thank you for giving us health, homes, families, and putting food on our tables, for giving us all that we truly need as we're camping out here in this world before we come home to you. We pray that you bless the offerings that are being given, multiply them so that we may continue your work here among our friends and neighbors in Muldoon and across Anchorage and Alaska. Amen. This is a song that's been kind of popular lately, kind of came out during the pandemic, and we just want to bless you with this song. If it's new for you, I think you can catch it pretty quickly, but let's bless one another with this. upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you, he is with you in the morning, in the evening, in your coming, in your going, in your weeping and rejoicing. To love and serve the Lord. He is with you. Amen. Amen. Thanks for joining us, everyone. God bless you.
Oh. Hello. Hey, Pastor. I was a little late. Our church ran late. I'm so sorry.